Arish Singh is a stand-up comedian, writer, and activist. He's based in Chicago. You may have seen him on the Triumph the Incel Comic Dog special on Hulu. He was kicked out of a Trump rally in Muscatine on January 24th with his friend and fellow stand-up comedian Taylor Williams. They raised a banner that said, "Stop Hate," and he called out Trump for his support that he's receiving from white supremacists. It was on C-SPAN, and we used the footage, and then Triumph the Incel Comic Dog heckled Arish Singh for heckling Trump. And welcome to my show, Arish Singh. You join
Thank
us
you
in
very much for having me.
You're in Chicago today, right?
I actually am driving back to Chicago tonight. I'm in Iowa City.
You're in Iowa City.
Mm-hmm.
The rally in Muscatine was a cold day. I remember this, and we saw Donald Trump. And we were warned beforehand that people are entitled to heckle Donald Trump, and that when somebody starts heckling him, everybody should start screaming Trump, 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 and drown out the heckler. And we look up.
Stay on brand.
Yeah. Stay on brand. And yeah. I look up, and there is a guy with a turban on his head. That would be you?
That would be me, in fact, yeah.
Are you a heavyset guy?
Sure, yeah, I'm a little bit heavyset, yeah.
And you were being thrown out. You were holding a white sheet. Usually usually at a Trump rally, they're white sheets, but there are three holes in them.
Yeah, yeah.
Nothing written on them.
No. different kind of white sheet, yeah.
And
I don't think, yeah, good.
Okay, so you disrupted a Trump rally.
Mm-hmm.
Why?
There's so many reasons, but the reasons that really were the last straw for my friend Taylor and I were these robocalls coming from the American Freedom Party, which is a declared white supremacist party.
And did you get a robocall from a...
I didn't personally, but I had a number of friends who were getting them on Facebook. They were getting them on their phones, and then they would post it to Facebook.
Yeah, I got a robocall.
Yeah.
I got a robocall yesterday from Marco Rubio, and he was actually on the line. That's how robotic he is. I just wanted to shoehorn that joke into the conversation.
That's a good one. Yeah.
You're a stand-up comedian.
Yeah, I am.
And you were wearing a turban, and your name is Arish Singh. So are you a member of Al-Qaeda, ISIS, Hezbollah? What Arab terrorist organization, the Palestinian Liberation Organization? What Arab, because you had a turban on your head. So what Arab terrorist group are you a member of?
I would never be part of any organization that would have me as a member, but I would be a Marx brother.
So you're a member of the Haganah. You're a Jewish terrorist.
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah.
Wait a second. So So
my terror group is based in the Catskills. So that's
Arish Singh.
Mm-hmm.
Are you Arab?
No, I'm not Arab.
Okay,
I'm
now
South Asian. Yeah.
You're what?
South Asian or Indian, however you want to.
Okay.
I'm from that part of the world,
your parents are from Punjab, India.
Yep.
So indeed. you would be Sikh, correct?
Yes, that's my religious cultural background.
And so as everybody at the Trump rally said after they found out that you were Sikh, you're an Arab.
Yep. They have their Trump geography down.
All right, so but you had a turban on, right?
Yep.
And there were no black people at the Trump rally.
There was actually a few people selling those hats, bootleg hats outside.
Yes. Nobody wearing a turban. There were people who had their brains operated on, so they were wearing some kind of stuff wrapped around their heads, but a lot of lobotomy patients, but no Sikhs. Do Arabs wear turbans? Do Muslims wear turbans?
Yeah. for Muslims to wear turbans, it's usually often like a very religious kind of person who will be doing it. It's right. not a very common mainstream thing. And it's even less so in the U.S. It's very uncommon to see that. If you run into someone in the U.S. and they're wearing a turban, they're almost always a Sikh.
Or they're doing a mind reading act. But at a Trump rally, they would automatically assume you're a Muslim, right?
Well, I mean, I guess so, but I don't know. Do you have to be by their assumptions? You know, like, I mean, I think that's been the situation for Sikhs or Sikhs in America. Both pronunciations are actually acceptable, but that's American, you know, to be yourself. You don't have to, just because other people are wrong, you don't have to back away and have to worry about them mistaking you for someone else. That's how I feel.
So says you.
Yeah, this is me. We'll see how things go under the Trump administration.
Okay, so your parents are from Punjab, India, and they and they moved to America when?
They moved here in the 70s, mid-70s. Mm-hmm.
And you were born in America?
Indeed, yeah. I was born in Chicago.
You were born in Chicago. So why do you have this thick Punjabi accent? I mean, it's like I can barely...
I don't know.
I can barely make out what you're saying.
Yes.
So you're an anchor baby, basically, right?
Not quite. my parents already had citizenship, but yeah.
Your parents said, okay. And you're an American citizen?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And you went to the Trump rally wearing the turban.
Yeah, indeed.
And you went there with the purpose to interrupt Donald Trump.
Yeah, and to protest, yeah. I mean, the interruption that I made was specifically in reference to these outrageous robocalls where they were saying, we don't need more Muslims in this country, we need more smart, educated white people. And that just didn't really phase into the news, and that people in Iowa were calling, you know, ordinary white Iowa people, you know, that we've got a lot of white people in Iowa, that's just the composition of the state, but they were outraged that this thing was happening. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he's been walking over that state, like, for the last 6 months, acting like, I can just say whatever kind of, you know, incredibly authoritarian, racist stuff I want to do, and you guys will just have to take it. You're polite Iowans, so.
Well, I mean, if we have smart, educated white people being brought into this country, that doesn't bode well for Trump's re-election, does it?
That's a very good point. Yeah, he may not. Okay, not so play to the base.
You walk into the rally. Were you wearing the turban as you walked in?
Yes, yes. I wear the turban regularly. Yeah, that is what I do.
Do you wear it regularly to get attention, or because you're a practicing Sikh?
I'm a practicing Sikh. I mean, I've gotten more into those aspects. I've always identified culturally, intellectually with the religion. It's a modern religion. It has a lot of tenets that are about modernity. Things like standing up for other people, that you should give service for other people regardless of whether they're your faith. Any faith can lead to enlightenment. You don't have to convert people. All these things I identify very strongly with. Yeah.
Is it
in the last few years have I become more identifying with the rituals of it, yeah.
And how related is the Sikh religion to Hinduism?
I'm not a theologian, but the way I kind of look at it is it came out of this period of intellectual ferment in India, where there was both in Islam and Hinduism this kind of moving towards a personal relationship with God, not through, trying to get away from some of the rituals, meaningless rituals. So I think it involves elements of both, and then it takes elements of its own and brings it in. If you look at it, just if you're talking in terms of like religious history, mm-hmm. Comparative religion, that's how it works.
How old is the religion?
Yeah, about 500 years.
Oh, it's a young religion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it's, would you say it's kind of like Protestantism in that it branched off from?
Sure, yeah. You can make a comparison. Some people talk about it being similar to that period in religious history in India being like the Reformation. I think of it, though, like more in terms of the Enlightenment to a degree. I think it's shedding. It was anti-superstition, against superstitions when it started out. You know, it has created its own rituals, its own superstitions. It's just like any other religion that has all its own problems. But the things that I identify with very strongly are the progressive nature of the tradition.
Okay. So you walk into the Trump rally, and they know you're going to heckle, right? Because they see the turban.
No. Actually, so this is kind of just by luck. We came really late when it happened. Pretty much everybody was seated. If anybody wanted to say anything to me, they would have had to stop, you know, looking at Trump speak and listening to him, you know, talk about whatever nonsense he was on. And
were you getting dirty? Did you get dirty looks from people?
I mean, we just walked right in, and then we went to the back of the hall, and then we came out where you see us in that footage, and unfurled the banner. We really weren't hanging around people too much that were there for it. All we had to deal with was the security check from the Secret Service, and that's really not a partisan group or anything, so nobody... Somebody asked me if I had one of those knives, jokingly, because some Sikhs do carry the kripon, but I was not... you know, that's not something I do, so...
Yeah. So, were you? Is this the first time you've heckled Donald Trump?
I went to one of his rallies. I used to be a writer here in Iowa City, an editor for Up Magazine, and I was looking to maybe do a story. And I went to a rally of his during the summer, and it was very bizarre. But I didn't heckle or anything like that.
So you heckled Trump, and you get thrown out. Were you roughed up? Were there brown shirts, jackbooted thugs kicking you? Did they spit on you?
No, he already had the police being as servile as they needed to be already. I mean, they were basically kicking me out. I really don't understand how easy it is for them to just not have to hire their own security. They seem to be relying on the local police forces when they do things. I was escorted by the police. There's one guy who came up from the stairs and shook his fist at me and said, if you don't get out of here, you know, I'm going to keep shaking this fist at you, I guess. I don't know how I'm going to say that. He wasn't an intimidating guy. Like, he was he looked like a really goofy, the goofiest Trump supporter you could imagine, just a very skinny, tall man, and just shaking his fist at me.
Were you scared?
I think what actually may have happened is that both me and the officer next to me may have rolled our eyes at the same time. You know, I did point out, like, hey, this guy's, you know, threatening to assault me. And he was just like, you know, just said, like, get out of here. You know, like, you know, the sooner you get out of here, the better everything will be. They were just really, they didn't do anything to me, these police officers, but it was just, kind of silly how much they fell in line with this kind of stuff.
Everybody had a role to play.
Sure.
And you were the protester, and you got thrown out, and you didn't resist, right? You didn't.
No, I didn't. I resisted this guy shoving me the way he did. When you can see in the footage, he was just almost trying to slap me out of the place. But
was that a cop?
That's it. I didn't resist. No, that was some sort of Trump organizer or something like that.
But he wasn't physically violent. He was just shoving you?
Yeah, I mean, he was shoving me pretty hard. And I do, like, you can, I turn around and kind of tell him to back off. But that's the extent of it. I didn't resist arrest I wasn't arrested, but I didn't resist them taking me out of there.
You weren't arrested, and then you were taken out. And did the cops talk to you on the way out?
Oh, yeah, you know, they took our information. They did all of that. Then they got the...
What do you mean they took your... What do you mean they took your information?
They wanted our licenses, Taylor and mine, and we gave them to them.
Wait. Why do you have to give them your license?
I don't know. I was just totally down to... I was not going to try to be in any way uncooperative about it. For one thing, I actually had to do a comedy show in the evening in Minneapolis, so I did have to. I couldn't stick around there. And I really didn't know. My friend Taylor Williams is from Muscatine. I didn't want to cause any trouble for him, so I was just down to cooperate. I don't know if they really had the legal right to do that or not.
Is it against the law to heckle a presidential candidate?
I'm not sure. That's the funny issue. They called the school groundskeeper over, and they were like trying to talk real tough, trying to intimidate us, and being like, "You want to charge these guys?" And they really couldn't come up with the charge that they were going to give me.
So the police. The police asked the groundskeepers, the people who were sponsoring the event, if they wanted to charge you.
Mm-hmm. The people. Someone actually, Taylor told me this. He's someone who works at the school. He came over. The police said, "Do you want to charge him?" They didn't say what with, and he said, "Well, I should charge them with inciting a riot."
But then you'd have to charge Trump with that too.
Yeah, exactly. Like that's already what they were going for. So yeah. And then the one of the officers I think said. We could charge him with trespassing. I vaguely remember that. Yeah. And I don't know if that would actually hold up or not.
Yeah, I have to figure like how I would react if people start showing up at Trump rallies, not Trump rallies, I'm sorry, Bernie rallies, and being disruptive. I'd like them thrown out.
I totally understand that, and I totally understand people taking me out of there. This isn't something... We both felt that the circumstances were ridiculous, that the kind of politics he was bringing out to Iowa, the things that you were seeing in previous protests of Trump, there was a protester, Rosamead, who was thrown out for doing only a silent protest. I find that kind of outrageous.
A lot of people like me saw Donald Trump in the debate on Saturday night and kind of fell in love with him for the way he went after Jeb. Is there any part, again, I'm not on his hit list yet, so I'm not as frightened. Are you frightened of Donald Trump?
I keep thinking, well, what I've been doing since this is, I didn't do anything immediately after the caucus, once he didn't win that. I did come out and start doing comedy routines based on what he said to me. Was he wearing one of those hats? And no, he never will. It was a very odd statement that he made. Some people thought he was talking about my turban. He was trying to insult me. People caught on to that. Then other people were saying, no, he's talking about his campaign hats, his overpriced campaign hats, which he's invested $400,000 of his own money into. Was he trying to work in a quick plug for that? So I disprove him on both counts in this comedy routine, and I've got one of his hats now, and I show that I can.
Are you scared? Are you scared? Are you scared?
I should probably get another patron from the ruling class to back me up, but I'm scared if we lose the kind of rights to do something like this, to have the most basic confrontation with someone who's got just huge wealth. That's all that rides behind him, inherited wealth.
But as a Sikh, are you scared? That he's going to get elected?
Trump himself?
Are you scared that he's going to get elected and that the country could move really far to the right? And make it difficult for people.
As a Sikh, I'm already scared. I've been scared for the last 15 years. I've been scared for all those people in this country who've been attacked in hate crimes. I'm also scared for Muslims who've been attacked that way. Anyway, anyone who's been done this. I'm also scared about the fact that in 2012, we had a neo-Nazi murderer come into, a neo-Nazi activist, he came into a Sikh Gurdwara in Wisconsin and killed... 6 people. He was shot, I think, a total of 10. That didn't faze the media at all. That should have been the last time there was ever an issue for Sikhs to be afraid. We were the victims of a terrorist attack in our own country.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it's just absurd. I mean, people want me, so I should have to clarify to these people at a Trump rally that I'm in fact a Sikh. These people should have known from 2012. That should have been national news. That should have been covered in every paper. I mean, the way forget about me. The way we've been treated in this country, we're citizens. We've been in this country for 100 years. Our first temple in this country was in 1912. We've been around forever. We have a history in this country, and we should be treated that way. It's that simple. So I'm not scared of. I'm not scared. See me in that video. Do I look scared? About the future, sure. I'm sorry, I'm losing a little track.
You're not scared. You're not frightened about the future. You don't feel that we're one terrorist attack away from you're not being able to do what you did at the Trump rally.
I'm afraid of the politics that have grown from the Tea Party and other groups. There have been more right-wing extremist attacks in the U.S. than any jihadi attacks.
Of course.
I'm scared of that kind of, how that's been
dealt. And hate crimes. Crimes against Muslims are up this year.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And Trump is epiphenomenal to that. I mean, having him out there, having him say things like there were thousands of Muslims cheering in Paterson, New Jersey, when the towers went down, and having a huge platform, that scares me. That specifically scares me. Whether he wins the election, whatever, it's emboldening those kind of politics. That does frighten and worry me, but it also frightens and worries me that people who are of my background, and South Asians in general aren't being proactive about it. You should be out there and standing up to it. It's that simple.
So he's, you get used to him, and all of a sudden,
sure.
He becomes amusing, and you forget how dangerous he is, and how dangerous speech can be.
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah. Words have, words and language have consequences.
Yeah.
Well, all right. This has been interesting. Do you plan to disrupt any other candidates' rallies?
No, I just plan to keep doing comedy routines where I disprove that little soundbite he gave me from there, and then asking everyone how completely inappropriate it is to have someone with this big of a platform saying that there were thousands of Muslims cheering at 9/11, and that's an attack not just on Sikhs and Muslims, but on South Asians in general in this country, and on our values. I know that sounds real preachy. It's a pretty solid comedy routine, though. So.
Yeah.
If I can work in the plug.
Great. Well, Arish Singh is a stand-up comedian, writer, and activist. He's also getting a master's in linguistics.
Oh, I have it, yeah.
You have?
It completed, yeah.
Oh, you have one?
Mm-hmm, yes.
And what are you doing with it?
Oh, I was teaching for a while with that at this university. These days, I do more writing stuff. I used to work in a magazine. I do copy editing work, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. And I would assume you're a fan of Noam Chomsky's?
A fan of Noam Chomsky's? Yeah, I definitely I draw a lot. I'm even a fan of his comedy, to a degree. After when people were really worried about how 9/11 could, what our response would be, the operation we declared after that was Enduring Freedom. First, we declared the operation Infinite Justice, but that sounded like we were jihadis. Mm-hmm. When we said that. Then second one was Enduring Freedom, and Chomsky's remark was a lot of the world has been enduring what we call freedom for a long time. So I think he's a good, he's sometimes dry in his prose, but he works on some good one-liners.
Yeah, and you studied at BU, right?
Oh, yes, I did.
Yeah, did you ever see, he teaches at MIT, did you ever see him speak?
I met him a couple times, and definitely.
Great. And how's the comedy going?
Very well. I work with a festival out here, Green Gravel Festival in Iowa City. There's a witching hour. I help book a lot of stuff within Iowa City, but I'm doing comedy in Chicago, and it's going very well. I like the people out there a whole lot.
All right. Well, I'm glad I got to have you on the show, and I'm proud of you.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
I'm glad you reached out. Well, yeah. I mean, anytime somebody does what you're doing, it's important, and you're a great American. And on behalf of all my listeners, thank you.
Thank you very much. I love how you look at political comedy. I think it's very important.
Well, great. And how do people contact you?
You can reach me at comedian Arish, A-R-I-S-H, @gmail.com, or I'm on Twitter at Arish, A-R-I-S-H, and then it's also I-S-H, so Arish-ish.
Thank you, Arish.
Thank you.